Whales show one of the most famous and best preserved transitions in the fossil record, as there are many prehistoric whales that act as intermediates between an animal like Pachycetus, that is clearly a land animal, to an animal like Dorudon, that is clearly completely aquatic. However, evolution is not a straightforward and linear process, and most examples of evolution sequences aren't actually direct descendants of each other, but rather share common ancestors. And some groups split off doing their own thing entirely. And this was very well demonstrated with the Remingtonocetids, that diverged from other walking whales around 49 million years ago, and whereas other whales evolved to become more aquatic and more similar to modern whales, they stayed semi-aquatic, developing long snouts and slender bodies to help them survive in their coastal environments. Most of the ancient walking whales have been discovered around India and Pakistan, like Pachycetus or Himalayacetus, that was a close relative of Ambulocetus. This is because 50 million years ago in the Eocene, this area was an ancient ocean that no longer exists, called the Tethys. The Tethys Ocean had existed since before the dinosaurs, but as Africa and India joined to Eurasia around 30 to 40 million years ago, and the continents took on their modern forms, this narrow sea was closed up. But this seaway was once home to many interesting creatures, and is where most of the evolution of early whales took place. Early whales like Pachycetus and Ambulocetus would have lived in the freshwater estuaries that ran off into this ocean, but the Remingtonocetids were one of the first ancient whales to migrate into the ocean, and may have even been strictly marine animals. This is known because their fossils have been discovered close to other oceanic creatures like saltwater species of fish, specifically marine catfish. But it is thought that they probably didn't stray far from the coast because some of the other animals that they have been found near, like species of ancient manatee or marine crocodiles, are seagoing animals that usually stay near to the coasts. Remingtonocetids were quite different from the other walking whales, as they had long slender bodies with long and narrow snouts, making them look a bit like mammalian crocodiles. One of the best known members of this group was Remingtonocetus, that showed how these creatures had taken a very different evolutionary pathway to other whales. But also, they were much more adapted to life in the water than many of the freshwater whales like Ambulocetus that came before. The body was more streamlined, and their limbs had reduced in size to limit drag in their marine environments. However, most importantly, they had made a crucial development in their ears for aquatic living. The semicircular canal system is an organ that is found in the ears of mammals, and is what allows you to sense your head movements, so it is very important for balance. In whales, the semicircular canals are a third of the size of those found in land mammals, as balance is less important in the water, but also it is thought having small canals reduces their sensitivity to the animal's acrobatic swimming, and hence prevents vertigo. Remingtonocetids had incredibly small semicircular canals as well that were not seen in the walking whales that came before them, showing that they must have been well adapted to the water, as their canals had reduced so significantly that anything other than crawling onto land would have been very difficult for them. But while they were in the water, it is likely they would have been capable of similar acrobatics to modern whales. So Remingtonocetids could go onto land, but were probably fairly awkward and spent most of their time in the water and almost certainly hunted at sea. A chemical analysis of the fossils of one member of the family, known as Danalistis, has found that it would have had a marine diet, and it is probable that all Remingtonocetids ate in this way. Dalanistis was also the largest member of this group, perhaps stretching to as much as 4 meters, making it as large as a small saltwater crocodile. Most Remingtonocetids are only known from their skulls, but one of the smallest members of this family, known as Cuchicetus, is known from a fairly well-preserved fossilized body, and it had a long, strong, and flat tail, but relatively small and weak limb bones, which has led some scientists into thinking that it may have swam with its tail like a giant river otter. With their tail swimming and living in waters close to the coast, they may have filled a similar niche to a sea otter. However, although their body shape and habitat may have been similar to otters, their very long and narrow snouts would mean that comparisons between these animals were probably not clear-cut. Sea otters have a generalist diet, primarily eating shellfish, and it is possible that Remingtonocetids were more specialized fish hunters, which could explain their long and narrow snouts, as these structures are commonly seen on fish eaters like dolphins or Gharial crocodiles. Pachycetus and Ambulocetus are usually credited with being some of the earliest whales, and show a fairly clear transition from an animal that occasionally wanders into the water to catch their aquatic prey to a fairly dedicated semi-aquatic predator. But Remingtonocetids showed the next phase of whale evolution. However, they were not alone in their excursion into the oceans, as after Ambulocetids, the whale lineage split into two groups, the Remingtonocetids and the Protocetids, that is the group of whales that contains animals like Rotocetus. Remingtonocetids are only known from various areas between northern India and Egypt, and nowhere else. This shows that they would have inhabited the northern and southern coasts of the Tethys, but never really migrated any further than this, staying within the safety of their coastal environments. Protocetids, however, were the first whales to really spread around the world, as their fossils have been found in Europe, Southeast Asia, and one whale, called Perigocetus, even made it as far as Peru. This shows that they must have been more adapted to an aquatic life than Remingtonocetids, and must have been capable of living in the open ocean for some amount of time. Having said this, the majority of them would have still had to return to the land on occasion. A pregnant Protocetus called Myocetus was discovered where the fossilized fetus was positioned for head-first delivery. Modern whales give birth to their young tail-first, so the infant doesn't drown during the birth. If Myocetus gave birth to their young head-first, it must mean that they had to return to the land to give birth. However, they would have been awkward on land, and probably didn't stray far from the coast. They probably had a relationship with land and water that was similar to seals, where they were good swimmers, but were only able to shuffle along the ground when out of it. However, it's unlikely that Remingtonocetids would have fared much better on land with their tiny limbs. Protocetids are the group of walking whales that were thought to give rise to the first whales that really started to look like whales as we know them today, and that were unable to return to the land. One of the main reasons behind this is that they had their nostrils fairly far up their snout, which shows a transition into modern whales developing their blowholes. But also, there were some members of this group, like Protocetus, that had a streamlined body and may have even had tail flukes, although they still had some primitive features like front limbs and a neck. By about 41 million years ago, the first definite obligate aquatic whales, the Dorodontids and Basilosaurids, evolved from the Protocetids. These whales had some primitive features and could be distinguished from modern whales, but they had completely cut ties with the land, and looked a lot like whales as we know them, and could no longer be referred to as walking whales or semi-aquatic. However, Remingtonocetids may have survived up to about 37 million years ago, meaning they would have shared the oceans with these much more aquatic whales. They branched off at a point in early whale evolution, but then never became more aquatic. Because their habitats were close to the shore, it would have been useful for them to return to the land, so they remained semi-aquatic. And because they never migrated into the open oceans, the placement of their nostrils remained unchanged. Instead of conquering the open oceans like the ancestors of modern whales, they settled as semi-aquatic marine hunters. Thank you for watching. A big shout out to my patrons for supporting the channel, especially the big contributors like Greenfors, Hunter and Marin, Ryuka, Grim Marshall, Sammy Voz, Brandon Klopp, Ken Ham, Nightrunner, and Crazy Cody. If you enjoy content like this, then consider supporting the channel as well. This video was dedicated to the late Smudge and Sugar.